And thanks for giving me the opportunity to present. Afternoon, everyone. It's afternoon here in Brisbane. I'm Dr. Abusina from the University of Queensland, Australia. And today I'm going to present my lecture on interfacial biosensing, a new avenue of nanobiosensing at the metal interface for detecting cancer biomarkers. As you can see here, these are the two recent covers published in Nanoscale Horizons and Advanced Functional Materials, representing our work on interfacial nanobiosensing and liquid biopsy technologies for detecting cancer. So let's have some outline of my presentation. So at the beginning, I will introduce you to the interfacial biosensing, and then I will discuss on DNA, protein, and RNA-based interfacial biosensing. And finally, I will we'll give you some summary of my presentation. So what is actually interfacial biosensing? People previously thought that the interaction of biomolecules with gold is non-specific. DNA, RNA, or protein, they are not really specific to give a signal that can be associated with disease. So that's why to develop biosensing methods, they use functionalization of the surface, and the way it works, let's, for example, our RNA biosensor usually finds which the target DNA they would like to capture or detect. And then they pass the target molecules, DNA or RNA, through the sensing surface. And if there is a match with the functionalized DNA, then it is a positive signal. If there is no match, it's a negative signal. And based on this method, they usually detect DNA or RNA. And also, for example, for protein detection, it's even more complicated because then usually you need to functionalize the antibody into the sensing surface. To functionalize the antibody, there are many other methods, but one of the most common methods is biotin step-edit methods, which involves the the adsorption of biotin elated BSA onto the sensing surface, and then you adsorb, and then you attach streptavidin to the biotinylated BSA, and this streptavidin then can bring the antibody towards the sensing surface, and then the antibody can actually capture your antigen. So one of the major drawbacks for this type of functionalization based biosensing is that non-specific adsorption of biomolecules non-specific adsorption of biomolecules towards the sensing surface, that can give you a false positive signal. And this is a long-lasting problem. Like these problems was one of the major problems in biosensing area. So what interfacial biosensing does is actually so what interfacial biosensing does is actually, you know, it averts the functionalization of the sensing surface. So there is no functionalized needed, and you can actually, measure the disease-associated signatures by just adsorbing directly to the DNA or RNA or protein towards the sensing surface. Based on because we know that during the disease progression, there is changes in the DNA structures or DNA or biomolecular structures or their function or the three-dimensional orientations. So that's why when in interfacial biosensing investigates the metal surface, and based on that interaction, they can actually identify the disease-associated signatures from the direct interaction of biomolecules towards the sensing surface. So how the interaction of biomolecule with the metal surface, but there are bases like adenine, cytosine, guanine, or thymine. And these bases contains nitrogen and oxygen containing functional groups. And through these functional groups, because they have the pi electrons, you know, we know that. So through these functional groups, that's why all lone pair electrons, these functional groups carry. So all these functional groups, they actually can interact with the metal surface. And for protein, this is the same as well. Like protein can actually adsorb towards the functional groups interaction as well. So that's how actually the biomolecule adsorb onto the gold or metal surface. And that's how interfacial biosensing works, by directly measuring the direct interaction behavior of biomolecules with the gold or metal surface. So now how we actually have, made this happen, like use the interfacial biosensing to develop cancer diagnostics. So let's have some discussion on cancer detection. We know that cancer is a disease that involves uncontrolled cell growth, and this is one of the leading causes of death across the world. And by detecting early, actually, we can significantly increase the survival rate, more than 95%, if we can detect the cancer early. So current cancer detection technique mainly involves a standard biopsy, which is a time-intensive procedure that involves localized sampling of tissues. It is not easily obtained. It involves pain, risk, and most importantly, it is invasive. So the goal is the current cancer diagnostic goal is to develop a liquid biopsy technique which would be quick, that involves comprehensive tissue profile, that would be easily obtained, involves minimal pain or risk, and that would be minimally invasive. So how can we actually develop liquid biopsy techniques for detecting cancer? We can actually analyze the biomolecules that carries the cancer signatures, for example, cell, protein, DNA, RNA, or exosomes. These biomolecules are they actually are present in biofluids, or for example, blood, urine, or saliva. And these biomolecules carry disease-associated signatures. And by detecting these biomolecules, we can actually develop liquid biopsy methods. So there are some liquid biopsy methods currently available, but these are mostly research-based, and they are expensive, time-consuming, and tedious. And the aim of, the current research is to develop a point of care test, which would be inexpensive, rapid, and plug and play. So that's how we actually want, and that's why we want to develop, and our aim of our research is to develop a non-invasive technology to detect cancer. And to develop these type of technologies, we used our interfacial biosensing system. So at first, let's start with the interfacial DNA biosensing, where we developed an interfacial biosensing system to detect DNA methylation, which is also a cancer biomarker. So methylation of DNA, the DNA contains, we know that DNA contains bases. So, DNA methylation is actually the addition of a methyl group at the 5 position of cytosine, and which can actually act as a switch to regulate the gene expression process. So how does it work actually? If you have, let's say, in your gene, there are regulatory regions. If these regulatory regions are usually unmethylated, the switch is on to run the cellular function, for example, protein expression. But if these regulatory regions are methylated, the switch is off for protein expression. Now, this is a really delicate process, and every cell determines which regions to be on and which regions to be off. And this can actually goes aberrant. The region that needs to be switched on, if it is switched off by methylation, then it goes abnormal. And that's why DNA methylation can be used. And this abnormal process can actually lead to cancer and lead to development of tumor. And that's why DNA methylation can be used as a cancer biomarker. Now, how do we actually use interfacial biosensing to detect DNA methylation? So the method involves the extraction of DNA from cell, and you may have a methylated DNA or unmethylated DNA. So what we did, we converted this methylated DNA We treated this DNA with bisulfite, and which is commonly called bisulfite conversion of DNA. And this bisulfite conversion converted the unmethylated cytosines towards the uracil, while the methylated cytosines remain unchanged. This is a common phenomenon. Methylated cytosines not, respond to the bisulfite treatment. And when we did the asymmetric PCR, this uracil converted to the adenine, and however, the methylated cytosine convert to guanine. And then finally, what we get using this asymmetric PCR in a DNA sequence enriched with adenine, and in case of unmethylated DNA, however, in case of methylated DNA, the sequence is enriched with guanine. The most important thing of this method is that what we have found that the DNA gold affinity actually follows a trend, which is adenine has the highest affinity towards the gold, however, and guanine has very low affinity towards the gold. So because our unmethylated sequence contains higher number of adenine, it provides more adsorption towards the gold surface in comparison to the methylated sequence, which is enriched with guanine. And based on this difference in adsorption, we used surface plasmon resonance-based system or electrochemical-based system to differentiate the methylated and unmethylated DNA. And let's have some data what we got. Like using surface plasmon resonance-based system, we found that we could actually detect 25% methylation in presence of 75% unmethylated sequence. And we also tested our method in a for electrochemical based interfacial biosensing system. And as you can see here, the electrochemical based system contains, so we tried different electrochemical based systems, which has rod shaped electrode or a screen printed electrode or a micro electrode that in a device. So there are three different types of electro system we use to detect DNA methylation, and we found that our method can actually detect 10% methylation and single CPG sites using the interfacial biosensing system. So we actually started this interfacial biosensing program probably in 2014. Until now, we have published several publications. But this methods of technique that involves, this bisulfite treatment, asymmetric PCR, we published in AnalChem, ChemCom, and Analyst, and there are a few other papers as well. But the major drawbacks of this system, this methods of system, what we call, is it involves bisulfite treatment of the DNA. It involves polymerase chain reaction. What is one of the major drawbacks of current biosensing system, because it's really time consuming. So our goal was to avoid these type of, like to improve our technology, interfacial biosensing technology, by avoiding this sample processing, for example, bisulfite treatment or polymerase chain reaction, and still we can develop a technology for detecting cancer. So that was our goal. And to achieve that goal, what we have developed is called Methylscape, that also based on DNA methylation based interfacial biosensing. But this is a different technique where we do not need this sample processing. So, and we termed it this as a 10-minute universal cancer test based on interfacial biosensing. So how does it work actually? We know that and it's based on DNA methylation, and we know that DNA methylation, there are significant epigenetic reprogramming occurs during cancer development. So in normal where the long intergenic regions are densely methylated in normal genome. So that's why the normal genome is actually really, really densely methylated. And in case of in reprogramming, the regulatory regions becomes clusterly methylated, where in the normal intergenic regions, becomes significantly hypermethylated. So there is a significant difference in global methylation levels during cancer. So what we actually discovered, when you put this DNA into the aqueous solution, the DNA aggregates, the normal genome aggregates. But in case of cancer, it is more dispersed in aqueous solution. And why this happens, what we discovered that, I mean, what we believe that this is mainly because of the hydrophobic nature of the number of methylation that makes this normal genome highly hydrophobic. And when we put this normal DNA into the aqueous solution, it is afraid of water, and that's why it creates large aggregates. However, in case of cancer DNA, which carries less number of methylation, and that's why this DNA is less hydrophobic, and that's why this is not actually, this is more dispersed in solution. But we also have discovered that not only this normal genome, these phenomena not only actually influence the solution-based properties, this can also influence the surface-based properties as well. So what we discovered that because of this behavior, solution-based properties, normal DNA actually absorb less towards the metal surface, for example, gold, in comparison to the cancer DNA, which absorbs more towards the gold surface. And based on these differences, the absorption difference, or direct interaction of the DNA towards the gold surface, we actually cannot differentiate, or we actually can identify cancer. So how the method works, we extract the DNA from blood or biopsy tissues, and then we adsorb the DNA onto the electrode surface, and then you measure the adsorption levels. So that if the electrode is empty, you get we used an electrochemical based systems where when you have an empty electrode or bare gold electrode, you get a current, which gives you a baseline current. And when we adsorb something, it blocks the surface area. And because it blocks the surface area, you get less current. So there are more blockages. If there are more adsorption, there will be more blockages and you get less currents. So as I said before, that cancer DNA adsorbs more towards the gold surface and then gives you less current. In case of normal DNA, adsorbs less towards the gold surface, and that's why it blocks less surface area and gives higher current. And based on this difference in current, you actually can detect cancer. We have developed another method, which is called naked eye detection method, using gold nanoparticles, and where you have the gold nanoparticle solution, which is pink in color. And then when we add your DNA and then incubate it 5 minutes, because the DNA has higher affinity, cancer DNA is higher affinity towards the gold surface, it's actually stabilize the nanoparticle solution and retains nanoparticle solution because of the DNA is negatively charged, and because of an extra negative charge coating, then nanoparticle starts to repel each other because of the negative charges comes from the DNA. So when we add 1 microliter of salt, because cancer DNA stabilizes the nanoparticle solution, it actually, addition of salt actually cannot destabilize the solution. So retains the color to the pink. However, in case of normal DNA, it destabilizes the charge effect, and because there is no affinity towards the gold surface. And that's how it changes the color to blue or colorless solution. And that's how we can differentiate cancer versus normal DNA, just by looking at the color change. So we tested our method using electrochemical system. We tested our method for tissue-derived genomic DNA. And as you can see here, we can identify cancer tissue-derived genomic DNA with 90% accuracy. We also tested our method for plasma-derived cfDNA, which is a liquid biopsy technique. And we actually can detect cancer cfDNA or circulating free DNA with 88% accuracy. We also tested our method in nanoparticle solution. And with nanoparticle solution, actually can also detect our method for tissue-derived genomic DNA with 76% accuracy, and plasma cfDNA with 78% accuracy. So Next, we also tested our method for extracellular exosomal DNA, or what we call also say extracellular vesicular DNA. So in this technique, so previous this paper we published in Nature Communications in 2018, and this year we tested this method on EVDNA, which has been published in Nanoscale Horizon. And so what we did in this technique, we isolated the extracellular vesicles or exosomes, and then we isolate DNA from extracellular vesicles, and then we adsorb this DNA towards the sensor surface or towards the gold surface. And we, in this method, we developed a highly sensitive multiplex device which can carry out 16 measurements at the same time. And then we, when we adsorb our EVDNA, we found that our method can actually identify cancer EVDNA direct from the patients in term.
Now we have tested our method where we developed interfacial protein biosensing as well. And so how the protein biosensing works, we, using our interfacial biosensing systems, we detected protein phosphorylation, which is also a cancer biomarker. And protein phosphorylation works actually, protein undergoes phosphorylation by the action of an enzyme called protein kinase. And it is a reversible process, can it can goes back to the non-phosphorylation level by the action of a protein phosphatase enzyme. So protein phosphorylation is a regular process where cells use this phosphorylation of protein to activate the protein for certain cellular function. So how the protein phosphorylation works, when a ligand or growth factor ligand binds to the receptor of the of a cellular cell receptor protein, it's actually becomes phosphorylated. So it receives a signal and it becomes phosphorylated. And this phosphorylation actually activates the molecules, activates the receptor, and this actually also activates the downstream protein as well. And that's how the phosphorylation cascade starts. So all the downstream proteins in the pathways actually activated due to these ligand binding, and the phosphorylation continues to activate until it reaches to the nucleus to produce a specific signal or cellular to generate a specific cellular function. For example. However, this process, this phosphorylation can go aberrant if there is a mutation in any of the protein involved in these pathways. This can go aberrant, and actually the phosphorylation can start automatically and continue to cell. Abnormal phosphorylation can produce abnormal cellular growth, and that's how it can lead to the development of tumor. And that's why phosphorylation can be considered as a cancer biomarker as well. So we used our interfacial biosensing system to detect phosphorylation. So actually, based on this, so we developed few different interfacial biosensing techniques last few years that's published in Biosensor Bioelectronics, Nanoscales, and time limitations or time constraints. And we'll discuss on nanostructures, mesophores, gold-based interfacial biosensing. And this is an improved system where previously you can see we used a flat gold surface, but in this case, we used a mesoporous gold surface, which is nanostructured. So we actually developed this mesoporous gold surface using a technology based on a polymer that involves polymeric micelles. And these polymeric micelles used electrodeposition into the flat gold surface and creates this nanostructure mesoporous gold. And using this nanostructure, because these mesoporous gold surfaces provides higher surface area, that's why it provides high sensitivity, or it can accumulate more biomolecules towards the sensing surface. So what we have discovered, that phosphorylation can actually change the adsorption level of DNA. So, and this is probably because adsorption level of protein towards the sensing surface. This is probably because we know that phosphorylation can change the protein orientation or protein's three-dimensional structures. And that's how, when a protein is phosphorylated, we found that there are more DNA, more proteins are absorbed towards the sensing surface when the protein is non-phosphorylated. And based on these phenomena, we actually developed our interfacial protein biosensing to detect phosphorylation. And what we have found that using the nanostructured mesoporous Golgi surface, we can actually increase the sensitivity significantly to detect phosphorylation based on interfacial biosensing. As you can see here, when we used a non-porous Fresh growth surface, we can identify cancer protein phosphorylation, but with a limited sensitivity. But when we use a nanostructured mesoporous Golgi surface, we can actually significantly increase the sensitivity and clearly identify the phosphorylated proteins. We also used our interfacial biosensing system for detecting microRNAs. And as you can see here, we used our nanostructured mesoporous Golgi surface to detect microRNA. And you know that to detect microRNA, we isolated the microRNA from plasma, patient plasma, using a spectroscopy encoded magnetic beads that contains a complementary strand towards our target microRNA. And in this case, our target microRNA was MIR92, which is a biomarker for ovarian cancer. So we isolated the target microRNA using spectroscopy encoded magnetic bead system, and then we released the microRNA from the beads, and we absorbed this microRNA towards our Golgi surface, nanostructured mesoporous Golgi surface directly. Since the patient's plasma contains this microRNA, or cancer patients overexpress this microRNA, so these microRNAs are actually present in cancer patients, but not in the normal or healthy people, healthy individuals. So when we isolated this microRNA, we found that cancer patient plasma contains this microRNA. However, the normal plasma or plasma derived from healthy individuals doesn't contain this microRNA. So when we absorb this microRNA onto the Golgi surface, we see that there's a significant signal because for cancer patients, because there are more microRNAs present in the Golgi surface, and we can clearly identify or detect the presence of this microRNA with very high sensitivity. As you can see here, our interfacial RNA biosensing method can actually detect 100 microRNA with 100 automolar concentrations. So this is a really, really high sensitivity method. So this comes to the end of my talk. And in summary, I have introduced interfacial biosensing methods for the detection of cancer biomarkers. It avoids, the main advantage of these interfacial biosensing system is that it avoids general paradigm of biosensing fabrication steps, for example, sensor surface functionalization. And methyl sorb techniques, our initial techniques which we developed, is level-free. It can detect 10% heterogeneous methylation in synthetic and cell line DNA samples. However, these methods, as I told you, require some sample processing, for example, bisulfite treatment or polymerase chain reaction. Later, we developed methylscape technique, which is a promising liquid biopsy test for screening many cancers, many cancer types suitable for point of care type rapid detection and multiplexing. And these methods avoids actually most of the sample processing steps, for example, PCR or bisulfite treatment. And this is really, really simple. And later we used nanostructure mesoporous Golgi surface, and we developed interfacial biosensing based protein and microRNA detection system. And nanostructure mesoporous Golgi surface actually provides an additional sensitivity in comparison to the flat Golgi surface for protein and microRNA detection. So finally, I'd like to acknowledge all the authors in the papers that we published in the last 6 years. We almost published approximately 15 to 20 papers on interfacial biosensing techniques in the last 5-6 years. And I'd like to acknowledge Professor Metro, Dr. Laura Kerskosta, Dr. Darren Colby, and Dr. Ellen Whitrick, and all other authors in the papers. And also would like to acknowledge the funding agencies, Australian National Health and Medical Research Council, Australian Government's Australian Research Councils, National Breast Cancer Foundation, University of Queensland, and Australian National Fabrication Facilities. Finally, you have my contact details here. If you'd like to contact me anytime, you can email me. And finally, I'd like to thank PEBLIW actually for giving me the opportunity to present in this webinar. Thank you very much.